In the second part, I will try to go in a further detail with respect to the topics that have been introduced by Luca in his presentation. Originally, he was also to discuss about the bridge with innovation, but mainly this morning his speech was about tariff and quality of service regulation. So we will have some more details about the technical aspects of these regulations. And I try to depict the Italian experience about the regulation for renewable energy sources. So at the end of the day, what we learned in the first part of the morning is we need to face a huge presence of renewable sources on our system. It has both economical and technical consequences. Especially technical consequences are the subject of this lecture here within the European context. But step by step, the menu is more or less like this. We give just some main figures about RES penetration in Italy and what are the existing barriers which need to be overcome in the perspective of a more intense exploitation of renewables. And then we will take a look at the technical impact of RES, which is both on transmission but particularly on distribution networks, exploring also new requirements which have been set up for generators on distribution networks. And also, hope I can do it, we will see something about the impact of RES on markets. We have two main markets in Italy, the day-ahead market, which is the wholesale market, the most important one, and also we have ancillary services market. So we will take a look at the evolutions which are on the pipeline by the regulator with respect to these impacts. So some figures. Very briefly, these data refer to year 2015. These data are provided by the transmission system operator Terna, and I just look at the percentages. So based on the fact that the main production in Italy is given by thermal production, thermal units on our system, they are the most important source and they cover 60% of production, but also we have very important RES assets. And at the end of the day, or at the end of the last year, RES units did contribute for around 50% of the overall balance. And this is the most important figure to me. So we need to manage a system in which the role of RES is no longer a marginal role. It is definitely no longer a newness for the Italian system. Rather, it is the something with which we need to live for the coming decades. And so 40% is the main figure in this slide here. And also take a look at this point here. We are net importers of electricity with respect to other European countries, right, because of the fact that the production cost in Italy for thermal sources is quite high with respect to neighboring countries, since we have by law no nuclear plant. So in Italy, no nuclear, very few coal plants. It's all with natural gas. Natural gas is around 50 euros per megawatt hour in terms of marginal cost. So this is why we are still net importing energy from abroad. Net import has to do with 15% or something alike. So based on these figures, what about RES? This is a point that Luca has already highlighted. So the installed capacity in RES is a monotonically increasing amount here. And so we are installing an increasing amount of RES till 2015. The share of this RES is composed mainly by hydro system, the first part of the blue bar, which is there for historical reasons, so since the 60s of the past century. And more recently, it has to do with wind, brown portion, photovoltaics, it's light green color, geothermal, and bioenergy, which is biomass, essentially. On the right-hand side, just a look at real production, so capacity versus production. It is gigawatt hours. The profile of production is quite uneven, and this is due especially to the blue portion here, which is hydro, because the hydro support to the Italian system varies year by year. So in 2014, we were very lucky with hydro production, so much rain in that year, and then the RES share was more than 45%. Then in the last year, 2015, since we had less rain, then it goes with this more reduced amount. So these fluctuations are essentially related to hydropower. And here I put, during the presentation of Luca, I had the time to mark what we are paying per year. So around 13 billion euros per year, which is more than 13 million bucks for a year. And this is a cumulative value. So this is the total integral value of all RES supports which are being paid on the Italian territory year by year. This amount is a really amazing amount, and it is going to be decreasing in the coming years. So in year 2016, which is right now, we are at the worst position ever. So this amount has reached the maximum value ever. So it will decrease in the coming years, and we will phase out this amount more or less 2030, because many instruments were initiated in 2010, and the duration of these instruments is 20 years. We have no time to give details about RES incentive schemes, but in a nutshell, in Italy, we do not pay for the capacity. Rather, we pay for the injection of energy. This is in order to guarantee that those plants will really be producing in the future and not just for getting the CapEx reimbursement, and that's it. So this is why we need to pay continuously over time these amounts of money, because they are related to green energy and not green power installed, right? So this is the motivation for having so long-term duration instruments. So based on this, there are new challenges for networks, because in the past, the electric system in Italy and in many countries worldwide, it is based on centralized generators. This is no longer true for us. RES sources, and this is common to all Europe, it is needed to hit the European targets, which you all know very well. So we have binding targets for year 2020, and these targets are being continuously revised. And very recently, 2 days ago in Morocco, there was conference of partners in Marrakesh, maybe. And even in that conference, new targets have been revised, and possibly further targets are for the coming years. The framework for Europe is we need an increasing share of RES. This has been done at the level of a single member state. Italy has its own targets. In order for hitting these targets, we need RES. In particular, RES comes in the form of dispersed generation, so DG. DG is going to be connected to medium and low voltage networks. And this is why we need to revise in a profound manner, especially distribution networks. And this is the point for entering the second part of our discussion here. So, what is the real impact of RES on transmission and distribution networks? Mainly, we need to face some technical challenges. First of all, currently, the system architecture, which is still valid as of today, this was chosen in the past, and DG was really very rare. So till 10 years ago, or all the way around, it is just in the last decade that we are in the presence of a strong amount of DG. Before, it was always planning the system with centralized sources. Nowadays, these RES are taking new challenges. So transmission system operators, first of all, they are called to have a system which is more flexible. And this has to do with dispatching resources and also with conventional producers. Also, RES pose new challenges for the transmission system operators for the security of the system. And I will show you some charts which have to do with the automatic frequency disconnection of DG plants, which put at stake the system security all Europe. And then we will see something about distribution system operators and to the fact that, in a nutshell, their networks, they need to become from passive to active networks. And this is a very costly, deep evolution of networks. Here I use a chart. I should put Siemens copyright. I don't do it, but anyhow, as if it was Siemens copyright. In our view, what we have been observing for the Italian system is that at the very beginning of this evolution, when the distributed generation amount was very reduced, it had a negligible impact. In my mind, it is a kind of relieving the load or making the load lighter than before. So networks are positively affected by this, and there is no need for any infrastructural change. Think about a house with a nice rooftop panel. The house is consuming more or less 3 kilo, Italian figures. If you put the panel, it will just consume less. So if the amount of DG is small, then the impact on networks, and here we present the impact in terms of euros, and you learned in the past discussion that these euros are needed for reinforcing infrastructures. These euros are taken from the pocket of Italian consumers with tariffs. So here we discuss about the impact of DG over network expenditures, which is essentially CapEx for new network infrastructures. So at the beginning, negligible. Then, when power becomes to flow even from the previous loads to the main station, then just you need to make the network a little bit more intelligent in terms of network protections, relaying some more schemes for protecting generators, and this has not a very serious impact. The very key point, or the point of time in which there is a substantial change, it is when ICT is needed, because a complete data exchange is needed to manage the network in the presence of sources which make the flow of energy go all the way around with respect to the initial design. So when there is the chance that the networks, distribution networks, I mean, they are functioning in a new manner, the technological newness which they need has to do with ICT. And so we need to provide some more infrastructure. It is no longer copper, it is more with electrons, fiber optics. And this is the very change in the mind of distribution system operators they are facing. As for transmission networks, I put this chart here, which is back to 4 November 2006, so more or less 10 years ago. So in that very time, it happened that in the north part of Germany, there was a transmission incident, not related to RES, just a transmission incident. So our German colleagues, they just made a mistake during a maneuver in the network. In Europe, it is well known that Germans do never make mistakes. So this is a very rare exception, but that very night, they made a mistake. According to that mistake, it happened that the total European system has split into three different parts, and I use three different colors here to represent this split of the network. Split in the network means that, and look at the frequency diagram here, that so till this point of time, everything was working more or less fine. And from now on, the network has been divided into three parts. These three parts, they do experience a different frequency transient. So the green, blue, and orange lines you see over there, they represent frequency in these three separated areas. After these frequency jumps, then it happened that there was a huge disconnection of DG units around Europe. Because at that time, distributed generation units were equipped with special relays to provide for local protection. We will go in detail about this. But clearly, after that incident, which again took place 10 years ago, when DG was yet very rare in Europe, not as today with 23 giga in Italy. So at that time, transmission system operators of all Europe really felt that there was a problem and the system could not be managed in a secure manner according to past regulation and legislations. So this is why we used to say that a profound change is needed also in the transmission system management. But look, we need to change transmission networks, or we need to refine the manner we use to manage networks because of DG units. So RES and DG are the main driver for this change. Back to regulation, since today it is for regulation. The total chart for regulation and technical prescriptions in Europe is very complex, but I try to make it a little bit simpler than reality. So look just at the top of the slide. At the EU level, so in Brussels or around Brussels, we have ACER, which is Agency for Cooperation of Energy Regulators in Europe, which is a legal institution, as we learned today. They act on behalf of the European Commission. So it is a very strong position. They have the highest powers in Europe for this kind of regulation. And then we have transmission system operators, which are grouped into another organization, which takes the name of ENTSO-E, European Network of Transmission System Operator - Electricity, ENTSO-E. Those guys are entitled to issue European codes. So we have codes which are valid total Europe for the total continent. And still in Brussels, we have SENELEC. I don't know by heart the acronym, but it has to do with electrotechnical regulation. They issue what we call EN, Euro Norm. So European Technical Standards. So the first level on the left, it is for regulation. Then we have transmission operators and right-hand side, technical regulation. The link between these operators is more or less the one I depict here. I put a red line or a red arrow in order to represent that there is a total guidance of ACER over ENTSO-E. So ACER gives to ENTSO-E some commitments. The commitment is, please, you need to prepare a new grid code. And the most famous code from ENTSO-E till now, it is named, I miss something here. Okay. It is named RFG, Requirements for Generators. So they give a commitment to ENTSO-E. ENTSO-E, they have the homework. They go home, they prepare the code, and then they get back to ACER, and they say, okay, well done. And this becomes a European regulation valid by law, valid total Europe. So this link is very strong. I use the red arrow to represent this. Sometimes the grid code, which is prepared by ENTSO-E, it is so much appreciated by ACER that they tell to ENTSO-E, okay, very well done, do it again. And so they kick them back and they prepare another code or a new edition, because the prescriptions in these codes, they are very strong and they will influence the total sector in Europe. So red arrow for this. Also, we have a green arrow, which has to do with the link between the Commission and SENELEC. Also, SENELEC acts in a manner with some coordination with ACER and with the Commission, but this coordination is very light. This is why I use this kind of yellow arrow. So more or less, SENELEC is a, I would say, a more democratic institution in which each and every member state technical committee, they gather in Brussels. We have nice meeting rooms with Belgian beer, white beer, and we make Euro norms. Euro norm is the one which, for instance, defines how this telephone will be made for Europe. There are Euro norms for products, Euro norms for systems. And this is the European level. Now, what happens at the national level? It is a kind of mirror. So in Italy, we have a national regulator. Luca is working for the regulator. We have network operators, Terna. They issue grid codes. And then we have a national technical committee, which is CEI. This technical committee issues national standards. So at the end of the day, even for Italy, we have this kind of link. This was not discussed by Luca in the morning, but to be clear, the Italian regulator needs to approve the grid code by the transmission system operator. So Terna prepares codes, but they are not valid unless the regulator gets a full approval of them. And many times it goes with, okay, very nice, do it again, and prepare a new version in order for the regulator to approve it. And also for Italy, we have a more light link between the regulator and the technical body, which is CEI. So this is more or less the framework in Europe. I think that this slide can be of help in order to understand how it works in our continent about policy, regulation, and technical prescriptions which are valid for this kind of sources. I don't know if there exists a similar architecture for the legal framework in other countries or other continents, but as far as I know, this is quite complex for Europe and it has been discussed for so long before we find a due balance of powers. So, given this total framework, what happened to our country and what happened in Italy? In Italy, it happened that the transmission system operator issued some specific annexes to the grid code, in order to face the presence of this amount of RES. In particular, we have two annexes here, apart from names, which is A17 and A72. These annexes are there in order for making the transmission network, including DG plants, more resilient in the presence of possible transmission incidents like the one we have seen in Germany. So with these prescriptions, the protection schemes to be adopted have been decided. And look here, there was also a process which we call retrofit. Sorry, not my PC, so everything can happen. I would like just to mark this. Retrofit, this is an important point, because not only we needed to put new prescriptions for new plants, and this is a little bit intuitive, but also we needed to put prescriptions which entailed changing and retrofitting existing plants. At that very time, we needed to retrofit more or less 15,000, so 15,000 DG plants already existing in Italy. And in a more ample sense, a small retrofit has been put atop also low voltage plants. In this case, we needed to retrofit several hundred thousand plants. Nowadays, we are at more than 500,000 DG plants in Italy, including low voltage, so including rooftop. So at that time, it was needed to go back on existing plants and retrofit these plants in order to make them more suitable to the new conditions. And this is a very regulatory point, since any intervention on existing plants is by definition costly and more difficult. And the same happened also for the new annex A72, which included new and also existing DG units. The purpose of this A72 resolution or annex, it was to put the transmission system operator in a better condition for curtailing also DG plants, which is not possible in many countries in Europe. And here the transmission system operator has the chance to disconnect either by the DSO or directly by producers these DG plants along the network. So finally, you see in this slide that there are provisions by the transmission system operator, so annex, and there are regulatory orders by the regulator. So 8th of March 2012, Luca and his colleagues needed to approve this annex. But since we need to regulate a vast amount of plants, it is not possible to do it with a grid code, which needs to be discussed one by one, so case by case. We resort to what we call connection standards. And this is the role of the National Committee. So CEI 060 and CEI 021, they are network connection standards, which are made mandatory by the regulator. So in this case, there is a technical committee, which is based on a very wide discussion with hearings with all parties, so including producers like Siemens, manufacturers, and also association of users. All interested parties are sitting in a big class like this, and then we discuss for hours. At the end of the day, or maybe at the end of the next day, we come out with a technical regulation, which is valid in itself, but also is enforced by the regulator. So it becomes mandatory. Mandatory means, to be very sharp, that in Italy it is prohibited to install some production plants which are permitted in France, in Österreich, wherever. We have a national code which prohibits some specific installations unless they conform with Italian standards. Even to be more sharp, we are clearly infringing some European directives about the freedom of circulation of goods. For some specific goods, like photovoltaic inverters, these directives are not valid in Italy. But we needed to take this very strong point with the regulator. Otherwise, the system is at risk, as we have seen for the blackout in 2006. And remember what Luca told before, we are not in the center of Europe. We are not sitting in the middle of Berlin. Rather, we are at the periphery of Europe. We are at the borders. and Italy is very long. And so we need to be with a higher level of security, and we need stronger technical prescriptions than they need in Brussels or in Berlin or in Paris, since they are in the very center of the continent. So this is why we have specific technical regulations which are valid only for Italy, and you cannot find them in other parts of the continent. Right? Every time we mention that we are infringing a European law, there is some. We are doing it on purpose, and we have good reasons for doing that. It was appealed in front of some Italian courts of law, but at the end of the day, it was recognized that security of the system and avoiding blackouts is a more serious point than European directives on circulation of goods. And so this is why we can afford having these national standards. Just a couple of examples of what the retrofit was bound or aimed to. This is Annex A70. It includes some special requirements for generators. If you look here on the left-hand side of the slide, there is the situation as it was before April 2012. So at that very time, in front of the nominal frequency, which is this dashed line over here, conventional units could survive in a very wide interval, spanning from 47.5 up to 51.5. So this wide interval could encompass any transmission incident on the European continent. The only case in the past when we got in trouble with this, it was blackout of 2003. Only at that time we were in trouble with these very ample frequency variations. But if you look at the second part here, medium voltage and low voltage units, so distributed generation, they were in a much narrow band, which is 50.3 and 49.7. This very narrow band, I have no time here for an ample technical discussion, but this very narrow band, it was for avoiding islands or avoiding islanding on distribution networks. So distribution network operators forced these units to abandon the system in case of a very small frequency transient like 50.3 and 49.7. This was the past life. After the reform, all units now, they have to live in these very ample frequency windows. In particular, all units nowadays, they need to be like conventional units, so the total tolerance band has become uniform for both big units on the transmission network, which is conventional generators, and also for rooftop plants. So at the end of the reform now, we are living in this more secure situation. These procedures needed to be retrofitted, and so these were the deadlines of the retrofit process, and the last deadline was last year in April. As you see here, we needed to intervene on mid-size plant, 50 kilo, for a total of 16 giga, but also smaller plants, less than 50 kilo, and very small plant. So any plant over 6 kilo has been retrofitted according to this new regulation. Just to give you an idea, in Germany, they are still thinking about how they can do it. But they are not very in a hurry, because again, they are sitting in the middle of Europe, so the chance of a serious frequency incident is very rare in Central Europe, what is very common for Italy. These incidents around 49 hertz, they can happen more or less every day in Italy. So this is why we needed to invest money of consumers in order for retrofitting systems. And this is for distribution network units. Just some few words about high voltage and RES on transmission system. In general, another infringement of European directives, in Italy we are very passionate for infringing directives, it is RES curtailments. You all know that in Europe we have a nice directive which states that RES energy has always the right of way. So the network has to be always available for green energy. And this is total true 99% of time. There can be some exceptions for this. The exception is that when there is so much RES that, like you see here, we have more RES than needed to feed the total system. This graph is for southern Italy in a working day, April 2015. So we happen to have more RES than needed for balancing the system. The graph is very simple. The curve here at top, it is load. And the dashed curve, it is what we call residual load. Residual load, it is the load which residuates after you consider the injection of local RES. And the yellow color has to do with the fact that it is mainly photovoltaics. So if you have more photovoltaics than needed to satisfy the total load, then it comes the time that you are at risk of curtailment. And so we needed to put in place some technical requisites in order to be able to limit RES production in that cases in which we need to balance demand and generation. And this is another important point which was faced by the Italian system with another annex, again with the transmission system operator. Again, let me tell you that this very situation is critical in the southern part of Italy. For instance, in the case of Sicily, Sicily is a geographical island, but not an electrical island, since it is well connected with the continent. So always we have the chance to export this excess energy to other parts of the network. But in some cases, the transmission capacity from the island of Sicily to the rest of the continent is reduced. For maintenance, for instance. In that very cases, really we enter the point of curtailment. And the same was experienced in Ireland, for instance. For sure, not in Central Europe, because in Central Europe, always they know where to send or to ship excess energy, because they can do it with France, Belgium, the Netherlands, wherever. So this problem is with the peripheral countries of Europe, like Italy, for instance, in some extent also Spain, right? Excess of RES which cannot be managed and cannot be exploited. And this is the point for curtailment. Let me just show you one chart with this curtailment, how it works. So in this chart, it is shown how the A72 requirements are put in force. The TSO is represented top left of the slide. There is a control center, namely the control center is in Rome. So Terna has a nice control center in Rome. And they are connected with the electronic highway to the operation center of DSOs. Here we put just two DSOs or two distribution center operator. In reality, you need to imagine that this stuff goes with more or less 20 control centers by DSOs. So we have more or less 20 control centers around the peninsula. So the critical network situation happens when, in a given zone of Italy, it is not a real-time incident look. It is just Terna is looking ahead of a couple of hours or 4 hours ahead. And their forecast is that they are having more RES than they can afford on the system. So the first point is they act directly on wind farms, which are connected to the high voltage system. But sometimes it is also necessary to act on small plants. Small plants, it is distributed generation in Italy. Distributed generation stands for less than 10 MVA. So if you have a plant less than 10 MVA, it will be connected to distribution networks. The new system which is now in place permits to the transmission system operator to send a due signal to the DSO, the blue dotted line, which appears now. This is done by the electronic highway. But then from the DSO control center, it is possible to reach dispersed plants. And these are the dashed green lines. This is done by ordinary communication networks. So we are using existing communication network, like, for instance, the GSM network. So there is a nice GSM modem at each and every premises of distributed generation units. A kind of, let me say, technical SMS is sent in quasi-real time. The SMS is received, and then Terna is able to disconnect this kind of plants in the case an excess of energy is forecasted for instance, southern Italy. To the best of my knowledge, this is kind of prototype or pioneering experience with respect to other member states. I could say that this is because in Italy we have very nice arrangements and good distributors. This is true. Particularly, it is true that we are the first country experiencing this problem. So we are entering this new world, and we need to find quick and dirty solutions, which is relying upon the existing GSM networks, in order for putting Terna in the position of managing the network, even in the presence of a very huge contribution from RES. In this case, the retrofit has affected only, I would say, significant size plants. So it is more than 100 kilo. The integral of these plants amounts to more than 10 giga. And it is a, now I go back to a question this morning, which was, how does the transmission system operator manage distribution system companies, or how is this interaction? This interaction needs to be regulated in a very cautious manner, because they are independent companies, so there has to be a third party, which in this case is the regulator, which is assisted by the technical committee, in order to put in force this kind of instruments, which clearly are based on the interaction between TSO, DSO, and producers. So the total chain has to be covered in a very cautious manner, because again, they are different companies, they respond to a different management, and they also go with different economical incentives or stimulus. So for doing this, you need to keep all the pieces of the puzzle together. So till now, it is the main points which are already in place in Italy. And again, these points have been achieved thanks to the fact that we have in place a good cooperation between the interested parties. So again, these points, they work because there is a good interaction between the regulator, the transmission system operator, and the technical committee. So this link in Italy, it is bidirectional. We have a representative of the regulator sitting at the technical committee, and all the way around, the technical committee can suggest to the regulator new regulations in order to favor this integration between different parties. But what is important is that in an unbundled environment, or in a market environment, like the environment of Italy and many other European member states, it is needed to have a coordination at the regulatory level. Otherwise, this will never work. So this is more or less one lesson learned from the Italian experience. Okay, right. So these changes have already been done. Now we take a look at what has been tested in what we call pilot projects. Also, Luca has mentioned in his lecture the presence of pilot projects. I would like to spend 2 minutes just to mark the difference between full-scale deployment, which is what I've been lecturing till now. So these provisions and these standards are valid for all existing plants. And this entails cost. We are talking about several tens million euros. And so before doing that, we need to be very sure that what we are doing is really necessary. Otherwise, we are wasting public money. Now, all the way around, for looking into the future, the point is, let us select some very specific areas. These very specific areas are very small and limited. It is the same approach which has been adopted in the UK, and in that case it was RPZ, rewarded power zones. So they choose, in that case, some very small islands. Italy has not that many islands in physical terms, but we need to select some specific primary stations which cover a very limited amount of the territory in order to experiment some new technological solutions. And so this is why, as we put here in the red color, we can experiment a set of technological solutions in some, I would say, showcases. So the total number of projects in this respect was around 6 or 7, very limited amount. Here in Milan, we have one pilot project. Another is in Rome, and other places in Italy. The total expenditure for pilot projects was less than 20 million euros. Less than 20 million for the Italian tariff is nothing. So this is to prove that the regulator has decided to invest a limited amount of money to test possible solutions and then, in the future, to use only solutions which have proven to be really effective and efficient for this purpose. I just to like to underline that the main purpose of projects or the technological enabler in projects has been the telecommunication system. So the main innovation which was experimented in these pilot projects was to put telecommunications on the field and to enable communication between generators and the distributor of the system. I just put an example here. This is one of the seven projects in Italy. I need to mark that these slides are courtesy of E-Distribuzione. So this is the Carpinone project, which was run by the biggest distributor in Italy. So this, at that time, the company was named Enel Distribuzione. As you can see, it is a limited portion of the territory in the southern part of Italy, where there is a primary station from the distributor, which is then connected to some generators which are spread around the territory. All the links which you see, they represent both the medium voltage network, so the medium voltage network is affected by these projects, and also telecommunication systems. I put just some figures here in order to make it more visible that we are studying a network which is beneath a transformer of 25 MVA. We have 5 medium voltage feeders on the network, and we have a number of what we call passive customers or loads. The core of the experiment is active customers. It is distributed generators. These guys, in that case, there were 5 hydro plants, combined high heat and power plants, and photovoltaic production. So the purpose of the experiment was just to let this portion of the distribution network, which again is a very limited one, it is one station out of 2,500 stations. So it represents a very small portion of the Italian network. And this is the physical consistency of the network. What is maybe more representative of the experiment is the architecture in terms of telecommunication network. So we have many levels affected by the project, starting from the control center of the distribution system operator. You remember we have 20 control centers for DSOs. Then the primary substation level 1 is affected. We have some stations along the network which are called secondary substations. And then level number 3, we have users, which are also affected. And all the symbols you see are there to tell you that we need to put in place new protection, monitoring, and control devices in order to make possible exchanging information between different parties, and also to make possible control strategies from the distributor to active users. So when we were talking about experiments, this is what has been really put in place. These experiments began in year 2011, and they are finished last year. So what is the main content, or what are the innovation in these projects? What I like to highlight is the concept of extended substation. So we are trying to extend the control and protection systems which natively are in the primary station also to agents which are external to the physical fence or border of the station. So it is like to send and receive some signals from the central place, which is the primary station, in order to reach dispersed generation. This is the main goal of the projects. These projects have as main components the so-called IED, which stands for Intelligent Electronical Devices, which are along the grid. So in a nutshell, it could be seen like making the medium voltage network more intelligent than it is right now. More intelligent means to disseminate the network with these devices and also to test different ICT supports, which can be fiber optics, Wi-Fi systems, in some cases the commercial internet systems, whatever you like, in order to see how it is possible to have a more integrated management of the network. I put just some functionalities, and as Luca has already told you, out of these innovative functions, two of them, after the project, have been selected in order for being implemented on a real scale, and it is voltage control, and also number five, which is monitoring of DG injections. So these two functions have been chosen after the experiment in order to go for what we call a full deployment. Full deployment means, okay, the test had good results, the functionality is really working. Now the regulator decides that it is worthwhile to duplicate or replicate this system, which at the beginning was on a very limited number of showcases, and to make it on a more ample scale, which can reach the full scale deployment. Let me still highlight the role of the regulator. Me on my own, I am a researcher, so I'm always in favor of innovation, especially if someone else is paying for this. And so experiments need to be with a high degree of freedom. So we need to be free of putting on field the best ideas from research, discussing with manufacturers, put in place a new test relay. Okay, an industrial relay comes with 2 kilo euros. A test relay comes with 50 kilo euros. Because we need to put in place new ideas, we need to go for prototypes, testing, development, whatever. This can be done with public money from tariffs only if we are limited in the total volume. And so it is freedom for research and innovation. Then there has to be a third party, which is the regulator, deciding which of these functionalities are really with an added value for consumers in order for affording a very higher expenditure like the one which is needed for full deployment. Then it comes with billion euros. So we are jumping from a very small scale total freedom to more serious things. The more serious things is when the regulator allows companies to take money from tariffs in order to make full scale investments. To me, this is a very narrow path, a very unstable bridge between research and public money, which comes from tariff. Just to give you some more details about the functionalities, let me jump into, for instance, the one functionality which is automatic selection of faulty branches and transfer trip. In this case, we try to make the medium voltage network stemming from the primary station here on the left. We just represent one medium voltage feeder. In reality, there are more feeders, but the feeder we represent is there to show what happens in case of a fault. So in common life, in case of a fault, we have all the line out of service, and then someone will fix the fault. In the experiment, thanks to the fact that we have communication systems linking all secondary stations, we can play a new game, which is, in case of a fault, a blocking order is sent from downstream to upstream in a manner that each and every relay upstream will remain blocked, and one only relay will trip, which is the only relay which did not receive any blocking order. It will trip, like the one here. In this manner, only the users downstream substation 3 are inconvenienced. All other users are still in service. And this is a manner of limiting interruptions, both in terms of number and duration. So these experiments are also at the border with quality of service regulation. Nowadays, 2015, some distributors are using the outcome of these experiments to match the new targets of quality of service set by the regulator. But at that time, this was not common business, and so they needed an extra money, which is input-based, we pay for the relays, in order to prove that these concepts could be of real use for the networks. Also, this system permits to manage in a more sharp manner active users, or DG, which is distributed generators, because the same relays are also sending a transfer trip order in order with the perspective of shedding those DG units which are in the faulty section of the network. Okay, this stuff is what we call automatic selection or logic selectivity, and it permits to have more quality of service on networks. Another point of experiments, it was with avoiding that frequency transient are poison for the system. And so here on the right, I put a very trivial scheme in order to represent that there are relays equipping DG units. These relays are what we call IPS, interface protection system. These systems are there in order to shed DG units, like this stupid photovoltaic sketch, in case of need. What is in case of need? In the past, it was we need to shed these plants even in the presence of small frequency transients. Nowadays, as I told you, we need these plants to be resilient and to be capable of keeping in service even in face of wide frequency variations. So the wide frequency variation has to do with 51.5 and 47.5 Hertz. So in this case, the relays which are equipping DG units are no longer valid for anti-eye landing. And so in the experiment, we put in place a new technique for permitting the shed of this generator. This new technique is based on telecommunication system, like from the red line dashed line. In this manner, we are able to shed DG plants even in the presence of an ample frequency interval like 51.5 and 47.5. So in this manner, we make the presence of those plants compatible on the one hand with the transmission system, which requires a wide frequency window, and on the other hand also with the distribution system, which requires that these plants are shed very rapidly in case of local fault. And what I put in the chart here is clearly a local fault. So in case of local fault, instead of looking at frequency, which was the strategy of the past, nowadays we just look at the presence of this red arrow, which means an inter-trip signal is sent from the primary station from the distributor to the user, to the active user. And so by this system, we can have a more stable transmission grid, even in the presence of many, many distributed generators on the network. So thanks to this system, what we mark at the end is that DG units are able to contribute to recover emergency cases for the whole system. While in the past, like 2006, it happened that those small agents are rapidly shed from the network by the presence of these interface protection relays. And this is another function which was tested in our experiments. That's a long story. Right. Third innovative function, and this innovative function was then, as I did recall you, this third function was indeed selected for full deployment or full scale. So the point is voltage control. The presence of DG alters the voltage profile over distribution lines. And it is not a rare case that DG units are shed by the relays in case voltage magnitude exceeds predefined thresholds. In particular, the rule for Europe is that plus minus 10% of nominal voltage is admitted on our distribution systems. Plus minus 10 for low voltage means 230 as nominal value, 253 upper value, 207 lower value. So in this magnitude window, DG units can stay connected, but unfortunately the presence of DG units alter the voltage profile, and so in many cases it happens that these units are lost and they need to be shed from the system or disconnected, right, for avoiding an excessive voltage perturbation. So this innovative function number three has to do with voltage control, and so we have two different stages in the project. The first stage, it is what we call a simplified control strategy. So each and every DG units operate with no coordination with other generators, and they react in a very common manner, which is in the presence of a voltage magnitude close to the border, they start injecting or absorbing reactive power in order for mitigating this voltage perturbation. And this was tested in projects. Also, in a further stage, we will go for a more coordinated voltage regulation, which means that at a central level, some signals will be delivered to DG units in order for them to inject a suitable amount of reactive power in case it is needed. And so voltage regulation or voltage control was one of the subjects of our tests. Please look at the chart over here. This is what we call capability chart of DG units. Now go back to the initial point of Euro norm and Italian legislation. At the time of the projects and up to 2012, DG units had no obligation to provide reactive power. So if you go and buy a photovoltaic inverter as of year 2012 on the free market, they deliver to you a nice inverter with blue and yellow colors, whatever you like, but please, no reactive power, not my business. I am here just to inject kilowatt hours in front of money. In Italy at that time, we put a restriction, and the restriction was from 2012 on, no more inverter with no capability chart is admitted. So we are admitting on the system only photovoltaic systems, photovoltaic generators, I mean, which are able to provide these services. No capability, no connection to the Italian network. So at that time, it was a very crucial discussion, because in a sense, we are limiting the freedom of circulation of goods. So if someone comes even today with an external panel, I will not say a Chinese panel like Mr. Donald Trump or China, but if you come with an external panel not manufactured in Europe, probably it has no capability of regulating voltage, because in the vast majority of systems, this capability is not required. Unfortunately, in Italy, it is needed, because if not, we cannot accept more RES. But more RES are needed to hit European targets. So at the end of the day, we found the balance. And the balance was, in Italy, for connecting photovoltaic systems, please, they need to be capable of providing reactive power. If so, then we can use this first or second stage voltage regulation. But as you see, it is a very narrow path, because we need to use components which in principle are the same for Italy, for the US, for any country, any continent, in principle. In reality, there is more than a good reason to put more strict provisions for Italy or for a special continent or for a special case, and these restrictions need to be studied with utmost caution. Okay, function number four, it is how to limit or regulate active power, but I have already discussed with you about this. So curtailment has already been discussed with Annex 72. Let me go for function number five. Even this function, let me recall you, was one of the functions which were selected. Selected by the regulator means that these functionalities have been deemed as positive with an added value, and so they will be widespread over the system in the coming regulatory period. So the point for this function number five, it is very simple to me. It is just to collect real-time information on the status of the power generated by distributed generators. And to me, the paradox, there is a paradox very simple to teach. It is the panel atop of my roof, which is a 3 kilo panel, does produce whenever the sun is there, and there is no information exchanged with the transmission system operator. So Terna is completely ignorant about the level of production of my rooftop plant. If I had only one rooftop plant in Italy, okay, Terna can afford it. Since we have more than 500,000 of these small guys, which total make some 10 nuclear plants, do you ever think that Terna can run a system with 10 nuclear plants which are completely out of their control? For sure not. So we need to provide Terna minimum with the knowledge of what is the current production of rooftop plants. And this is the purpose of this function number 5. So to be able to collect information and to send this information to the operating centers of the DSO in order for them to manage networks in a more effective manner, even if there is a high DG presence. And also, they will tell the story to the TSO, for the TSO to be aware continuously over time. And there is no longer a big question mark in the face of Terna employees, which is how much of the system is resting upon rooftop plants. It's really a nightmare. So this function number 5 has been designed and then approved by the regulator in order for going for a full deployment, right for this purpose. So to provide Terna with data from dispersed generation, which is actually not in the hands of the transmission system operator. Anyhow, what has been observed that there is an impact of RES on markets, and I would like just to show you a couple of charts, which are a little bit sophisticated. The chart at top left, it is the ratio, so it's not an absolute value, it's a ratio. It's a ratio between the hourly price and the average price nationwide over a year. So the average price we pay for total year for energy, it is represented by the point here with 1. So in front of this central line 1, the curves depict how the price varies with time. So the blue curve has to do with 2008, for instance. If you take a look at the blue curve 2008, you will observe that there were very ample variations from day to night. So from the minimum load overnight at 4 a.m. this morning, I am paying energy more or less a half of the average value, 0.5. And at the very top here, I get to pay energy in a hourly tariff more or less 1.4, which is 40% more than the average. It means that the value of energy is pretty much diverse over the 24 hours of the day. At least this was true in the past, blue curve, 2008. Then it comes with other colored curves. And to save time, we can just take a look at the most modern curve, which happens to be 2015, like here, which is the red curve. The red curve is a little bit flat with respect to the past. So there is no longer a significant difference between the prices off peak, and now it is 0.8 more or less here, and peak price, which is more or less 1.2 over here. And this is due to the presence of RES, because renewable energy sources, which in Italy coincide with sun photovoltaics, as you learned before, they are able to match exactly the peak load of the past, which is a kind of around noon or in the afternoon. And so thanks to this effect, now we have a less ample variation in prices, which also has taken a total revolution in the day-ahead market price. And so the price over the Italian market, I didn't put in the charts, but just to tell you, it was around 100 euros. I'm talking about euros per megawatt hour in the very past, like as of year 2005. And nowadays, which is 2115, it's going to be less than 40 euros, 40, 50 euros. This is why I told you the joke before that after we pay 15 billion, then RES energy comes for free. In the sense that all the amount of RES energy, which is incentivized and not paid with this figure, because... Yeah, it's the other part. So the part of the bill which has the name energy is diminishing, But the part of the bill which has the name support to RES, it is increasing. So at the end of the day, but if you look only at the market, because the point of this last half an hour is just at the market. If you just look at the market, the effect is this kind of prices are more flat over time. Also, very anti-intuitive, prices, they do increase during the evening, because right in the evening, the sun production begins to decrease. And then in that very hours, we have a fictitious peak load, which is the load not covered by photovoltaics. And this is the day ahead. Just take a look at the ancillary services. We have a secondary market which goes for network service, in a nutshell, providing the balance, providing secondary frequency regulation, tertiary reserve. So the secondary markets, which are less important in terms of total money, but still they are important for the expenditure from Terna. In Italy, in Italian, it takes the acronym of MSD. MSD stands for Mercato per I Servizi di Dispacciamento. In English, Ancillary Services Market. So volumes of the market are so much increased, and we have the need for more reserve, because sun and wind, they are largely unpredictable. So we need to be prepared to jump into the system with some 5 giga thermal units, right, because wind is there, but it could stop in the next 5 hours. So increase the reserve. And also, we need to operate a system with a low demand, because RES production will lower demand during summertime. So these are the challenges on the markets. To be honest, the decrease in prices from 100 to 50 on the day ahead has many causes. One cause being the price of oil, which has been constantly decreasing over time starting 2005. And also there are political causes. I don't like to enter this part, but as you well know, there's a bunch of reasons for the price of energy changing so much in a country. Anyhow, also renewables have their influence over this change. This is to me an interesting chart. I learned it some days ago from a seminar from the regulator, so I just copy and paste the slide. This is to tell you what is the net efficiency of the electricity production units in Italy. Here I'm talking about conventional production. So this stuff goes with combined cycles, what you know in the international literature like combined cycle gas turbine. As you know, in Italy, they cover the vast majority of base load. So the bill we pay for thermal is essentially for natural gas, which is transformed in these CCGT plants into electricity. Look, this is efficiency. So in 2004, when these units were really used to cover a quasi-flat load, they were able to transform natural gas into kilowatt hours with an efficiency around 55%, which is close to the technical limit. You can look at some papers with Siemens that say that their biggest turbine was able to go for 60% in a very special day in the coastal side, I don't know, in Alaska, wherever, they could do 60%. So 55 is a really good figure for average efficiency of the national park. But over time, the effect of RES is that now we are not able to reach 50%, because natural gas plants continuously, they are ramping up and down. They are shut down overnight, which is killing them from a maintenance standpoint, from a mechanical standpoint, but also is killing them from the purpose of total efficiency. So this is a bad effect. We do not count for this effect when we say the incentive goes with 150 billion, blah, blah, blah. But this is a cost. It is not an evident or upfront cost, but this is a cost, because producers, sooner or later, are going to put this cost on the bill of Italian bill payers. So you need to consider the total picture. So focusing now on the ancillary services market. What is going on right now? It is a profound reform of the ancillary services market. Currently, this ancillary services market is only for very big units, more than 10 mega. So this is the current limit for being eligible for this very special market. And also you need to have some special technical requirements, for instance, to vary active power very fast over time. So as of now, these requirements exclude from ancillary services market all units which are fed by RES. So in short, today, RES, they contribute only to the main good, which is energy. But when we need, let me say, more intelligent or flexible energy, resources are not used. And so, as of now, only big plants are eligible for this special market. So what we need for the future is more resources for dispatching. And look, it is very funny because we need more resources which are conventional resources, so CCGT plants. But increasingly, those plants are kicked off the market by RES. So we need more support by a special kind of plants which are no longer with us. So the point is, we need also to encompass the presence of RES in the new dispatching. But unfortunately, RES, they come in the form of DG, and they are connected to medium and low voltage. And so we need that in the future, those guys participate really in the market. And so this is the point of time the Italian system is right now. What we call the dispatching reform is going on in the last 3 years at least, but till now we are not able to find any practical solution. So by the end of the year, a new resolution by the regulator is expected in order to address this evolution. The purpose in general is to enlarge the scope of the ancillary services market. And look, for some purposes, even small plants can be extremely of use. Here in this chart, I put just the contribution which can be achieved if you include also RES plants in this ancillary services market. So now we are talking about small plants, generator connection to distribution system, so less than 10 MVA. So small generators can contribute so much to balancing the system. And they can do it in many different manners. For instance, we have many thermal plants, combined plants, the ones we mentioned with biomass. In this case, they may have good capabilities or fairly good capabilities to offer their services over the market. I know this is quite anti-intuitive, but a wind power plant has very good characteristics. It will respond in a very good manner to load changes, and it has a more than good flexibility. And the same is valid for PV plant. Typically in the past, you have heard discussion about this plant is very flexible, this thermal plant can ramp up in a few minutes. This photovoltaic plant can ramp up in 0 seconds. It can do it just very, very fast. And the same is to ramp down. There is no mechanical part to be inconvenience. It is just a matter of power electronics. So in principle, the technical capabilities of RES plants are much better than the technical capability of conventional plants. You just need to overcome a kind of psychological barrier, which is, okay, I don't need to inconvenience RES plants. Those guys are there for the good of the nation. No, those guys are there to take part in the market. Just we need to find more intelligent rules in a manner to be able to attract these guys into the market. And this is a very tricky part of the game. In Italy, since 3 years ago, we had imagined different possible business models for including RES generation into the system or into the market. And I just have the time to show you some charts. In particular, I will stick to the so-called model number one. In model number one, it was imagined that the system operator can resort to big units like conventional plants, but also wind farms. And then the same transmission system operator can also resort to small units like DG, but not directly, but by means of an intermediate agent, which is the so-called trader or aggregator. The story I'm telling you right now is not yet possible in Italy. So to be very sharp, if I have my rooftop panel or even a 2 mega photovoltaic field and I'm very proud and courageous, I want to take part in the market. No, this is not for me. I'm not eligible for this kind of market. So to me, in a sense, this is a kind of legal barrier against my participation into a market. Then we need to jump into a second order discussion, which is, are you sure you're making money? Don't ask. For the time being, I'm sure that I cannot do it. So this has to be a little bit rethinked completely, because nowadays there is this kind of limit. So in this model one for dispatching, it was imagined that Terna could resort even to small units in order to make the system more flexible. That is what we really need right now. And just let me tell you another part of the story, which is to me anti-intuitive. When we talk about curtailment of a DG unit or curtailment of a RES plant, curtailment sounds like a bad word, like, bah. Curtailment to me is the first nutshell of dispatching. It's the first dispatching action. It's a very bad and violent action because it is, please go by. But it's a form of dispatching. So when I get curtailed, I'm not very happy. But if I get some money in change, I could be a little bit happy. So we are already dispatching DG units. We are already dispatching RES. Even if the name is not dispatching, it is curtailment. So in the future, we think that just changing the names to the things we already do could be beneficial for the system. And so what we imagine could happen or hope could happen in the future is the arrangement you see over here. The chart has three colors, but it's quite simple. So you need to imagine that there is the TSO atop, and in Italy it's very simple. We have one TSO. We have distribution system operators, green color. The dashed line is the border between the transmission network, which is under the hands and in the powers of Terna. So those guys are till here, and then it comes with distribution networks, which are in the hands of DSOs. And then there is a third party in the game, which is the aggregator. The aggregator is a brand new agent, which is already in place in some countries in Europe, not far from here in Austria, for instance. The purpose of the aggregator is to gather the contribution of DG plants, which are connected to medium voltage networks, like here. So you need to imagine that there are generators here. The contribution of these plants can be acquired by the aggregator from DG users, and then the aggregator will sell these services to the transmission system operator. So this new business scheme will allow the participation of small units even to the main market. And so this is what is going on in these very months in Italy. Also on this purpose, it will be very important to take care of the TSO-DSO coordination, because now distribution networks are more active and there are some agents on the distribution system which will be directly governed by a third party, which is the aggregator. So this is a kind of future projection of what we expect will be for the Italian system in the coming future. And this should be valid starting January 1st, 2017, so in 2 months. In 2 months, it's just a world of dreams. In reality, it will take minimum 6 months for half next year for the first experiments, and hopefully January 1st, 2018, if you are back to Italy for another seminar, I hope I can tell you the story with this kind of plants being really eligible for the market. So that's all by me, more or less. I'm here for questions.